Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most gracious, peace be upon you, brothers and sisters from everywhere. Insha'Allah, today we are going to start our beautiful night by praising Allah and thanking Him for all the opportunities He had given us. We are thankful for Him forgiving our shortcoming and opening the doors that we have never thought of, and also closing the doors of harm that we have never thought of. We send blessing upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace be upon him, and we ask Allah to bless every one of us and grant us goodness.
Inshallah.
The bitterness of being separated from the coziness of the home and the warmth of the family gathering is a challenging. It is very challenging to the knowledge seeker. Having a big dream means to step outside those boundaries, step outside your comfort zone. Isolation and homesickness, yet ambition and the urge for gaining knowledge. These are the things that simultaneously seem attractive, yet alienating to the knowledge seeker, us, the students. Now, as they make their education journey enjoyable, they can either make it there are two forms in which students can go through their educational journey. Now, they can either make it an enjoyable stroll in the park, or they can make it a confusing maze full of dark twists and turns that can only lead up to two of the ultimatums, two possibilities. Now, it could either lead to one of the two final ultimatums. One of them being gaining an ultimate experience, which would completely change your outlook on life. And the other is falling behind. Now, the accumulated experiences of good companionship in this journey will sweeten one's journey in life, or once will sweeten one's life's bitterness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace be upon him, said that to a believer is like a solid building, one part supporting another.
It is also worth mentioning that the companionship which comes first to the Muslim is that one of the Holy Quran. And now please earn us your earrings, and let's pay attention to the heart-comforting ayats recited by the student Ayub Shreqi.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ألم تر أن الله أنزل من السماء ماء فأخرجنا به ثمرات مختلفا ألوانها ومن الجبال جدد بيض وحمر مختلف ألوانها وغرابيب سود ومن الناس والدواب والأنعام مختلف ألوانه كذلك إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء إن الله عزيز غفور إن الذين يتلون كتاب الله وأقاموا الصلاة وأنفقوا مما رزقناهم سرا وعلانية يرجون تجارة لن تبور ليوفيهم أجورهم ويزيدهم من فضله إنه غفور شكور. صدق الله العظيم.
صدق الله العظيم. Human beings become speechless, especially when their words seem hard and insufficient to express their complicated feelings. So a silent tear or even a pleasant voice will be a better alternative to words. So inshallah, tonight, Ya Rab al-Afari is going to please your hearing with his beautiful voice.
My best times when I felt close to you, everything fell apart. Moment I strayed from you, in each smile, in every single sigh, every minute details, traces of you are found there. Wherever you are, I find you, 'cause you're the one I turn to. Wherever you are, I find you, 'cause you're the one I turn to. Wherever you be, I be with you, 'cause you're the one my heart is to. I need you. زمان غريب قليل السكن وليل وحيد كثير الشجن وحيث تكون سوف آتي لأنك أنت اختيار حياتي وحيث تريد وجودي أجود فأنت كلامي عند سكاتي يا رجائي وأنت جمال على بيت شعر يردده الناس عبر الزمن على كلمات منك داب اغترابي وأنسى بصوتك كل عذابي وحيثما تكون.
Dear brothers and sisters, please lend us a ear to get rid of your sorrows and by the will of Allah, inshallah. During the years of hard work and abroad, you may face a lot of difficulties studying abroad. For the great goal and for the faraway homeland, students will face a lot of difficulties. And sometimes these difficulties might even completely stop them from acquiring and advancing their knowledge. And hence, we are happy to introduce Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim Al-Ma'wali tonight to share his experience in an open panel discussion. May we ask Allah to grant us the goodness and, inshallah, the knowledge as well. After the precious talks presented by the Sheikh, inshallah, you will have the opportunity to ask your questions. May I present to you now Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim Al-Ma'wali.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Was salatu was salam ala ashrafi khalqillah ajma'in. Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsan wa iqtafa atharahum wa sar ala nahjihim ila yawmiddin. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful, all praise belongs to Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Our beloved, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and those who follow him rightly and correctly till the day of resurrection. Dear brothers and sisters, first and foremost, I would like to salute you all with the salutation of peace, with the salutation of love, with the salutation of the people of paradise. تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. It gives me actually a great pleasure tonight to be amongst you, and I would like to express my gratitude to the Islamic Cultural Society for inviting me, in particular the supervisor of this society, our respected brother Ustaz Muhammad Al-Sabi, and to the rest of the organizing committee, brothers and sisters. And thank you all also for attending and being part of this event tonight. Also, I would like to make two disclaimers. One of them, if you're after a charming talk from a charming speaker, then I'm afraid you might be in the right place in the wrong time. Another disclaimer, if you are also a long experienced speaker studying in the West, then that might not apply to me, because I spent in the West just for maybe 1 year and a half, and that's all my experience, which I try to share some of its stories, some of its encounters over the course of around 16 months studying in the West, doing my master's degree, which was in the 2 years of 2014 and 2015. So it is a good evening and opportunity for me to refresh my memories, to consult my memoirs. So I'm gonna share some of these interesting stories. However, I'll start first with the title of tonight's meeting, Lend Me Your Ear. I was asked by the organizing committee to propose some titles for tonight's event. So I sent a list of titles. To my surprise, the very last title was chosen, Lend Me Your Ear. Although this title is quite vague, why doesn't relate specifically to our tonight's topic, but it amazed me. Why is that? Because of the fact that this particular title and a few number of titles, which are called idioms or idiomatic expressions, are even found in Arabic language also. So this title was translated, as it was announced in the poster, as A'irni Udunak. And this is not confined to this particular idiomatic expression or idiom. There are a number of idioms in English that conform to idioms we have in Arabic, idioms and proverbs in Arabic. This reflects two things, which serves an introduction to our tonight's topic. First of which, this reflects the integration of cultures between the Western culture and the Eastern culture. So there was no entire separation between the Arabic culture and the English culture. There was a sort of intermarriage between the two cultures. So one culture borrowed from the other culture. And that means there was a sort of integration between the culture and obviously between the people of the two cultures. And we are here tonight to boost this idea, the idea of integration, because otherwise the lack of integration is a reason for intolerance, is a reason for fanaticism, is a reason for so many complicated things that we suffer and experience in today's world, like extremism, terrorism, and so on and so forth. So what I have just mentioned is one example. And I was told by more than one native speaker of English that using English idioms makes you integrate in the society, because English people like and love idioms, and they use idioms as well. And when you use their own idioms, that breaks the psychological barriers between you and the other, and that makes the process of integration very, very much easy. And here I recall my encounter with the writer of this book, Christianity in Oman. This book might surprise many of you, but I'm not gonna tell you the content of this book, because it was translated into Arabic. Inshallah ta'ala, I did the translation in 2019, and it will be launched at Muscat International Book Fair in 2 weeks' time. So, I invited the author of this book to my house. He's an Englishman. He's now 75 years old, or 76 years old. He worked here in Oman in the 80s, in the ninth decade of the 20th century, in the 80s. And while he was here working in Oman, he wrote this book, Christianity or Christians in Oman. I invited him to my house, so he flew from England all the way to Oman, to Muscat. I hosted him in my house. I used a number of idioms while chatting and talking with him, and he loved them very much. And he said to me, "You like English idioms, and this is the way to integrate, to penetrate and break through the hearts of others." I remember once he was expressing that he has to tell his wife everything that he is doing in Oman. So I told him that your wife is trying to put you under her thumb. So he left, because this is an English idiom. And on his very last day in Oman, or in his penultimate day in Oman, the day before his travel, he was very concerned. He was trying to bookbind a book, a PhD thesis. You know, bookbinding, when you put the cover. So he brought like a PhD thesis, he printed it out, and he wanted to put a cover for it. He wanted to give it as a gift to Sheikh Kahlan Al-Kharousi, the assistant grand mufti of the Sultanate. So he was very concerned, because it was Friday and the bookshop is closed that day. I told him, if you don't find a bookbinder to make covers for the book, write on the cover, "Mr. Kahlan, never judge a book by its covers." So he loved it. Then he invited me to his house in the southern England, in the south part of London. So I visited him last summer. And he and his wife were arguing together. It seems his wife wasn't pleased with some of his proposals and ambitions. So I told him, "Reverend Ray Skinner," his name, Ray Skinner, "it seems your wife is objecting because of this particular reason." And we were sitting on a sofa. He took a hammer from his sofa, next to his sofa. He extended his hand, stretched out his hand. He took a hammer and he said, "You hit the nail right on the head," which means you gave the precise reason why she is objecting to my proposal to extend and the house and so on and so forth and sell part of it. Anyhow, so these are some of the proverbs. I encourage you, those of you who are willing to study or having to study abroad, to use proverbs, because it breaks the barriers and they make you like one of them. This is what I was told by one of them, using proverbs and idiomatic expressions, breaks and removes these barriers. And as I said, there are proverbs similar to what we have in Arabic. For example, this proverb, don't or never judge a book by its covers. Kill two birds with one stone. For example, don't put your eggs in one basket. And a number of them, some of them are even modern, like the ball is in your court. So some of them are even modern. So this is my first entry to this session. The topic, as was announced or made clear by this generous introduction, thanks for the moderators, it will be about sharing some experience from my little experience studying in the West. So I want to make it clear also, another disclaimer from the beginning, that whatever I say tonight should not be taken for granted. It only should be treated as personal experience, self-reflection, personal impressions. They don't have to be like taken as indisputable facts. They reflect, I might be correct or might be wrong. As long as it reflects my own experience, this is what I meant by sharing these stories. However, I believe they are in total conformity and compliance with our Islamic tradition. So I have I had a number, or let's say countless, of discussions, especially with academics specialized in Islamic studies. And this leads me to the most frequently asked question. How come you leave your own country, your home country, to go to the West to study Islamic studies? This is the most frequently asked question, either here in Oman or there in Britain. How come you come to here, to the UK, to study Islamic studies? Don't you have there back home Islamic studies departments? Some of them even say you have their Mecca and Medina. So why don't you go to Mecca and Medina to study Islamic studies? And this question, I think, makes sense. So I answered to them, there are two reasons for this, for me coming to the West, to non-Muslim country, to study Islamic studies. One of them, I'm coming part of the program, part of a program that sends only students to a certain number of countries, and none of them the countries you mentioned. So all of them actually, I think, are English-speaking countries. And the second reason is that I want to study Islam from a Western perspective, not from an Islamic perspective, because there you have Islamic studies department or programs, at least in most of the major British universities. They have Islamic programs, Islamic studies program. So they study Islam in depth. And there are professors and academics who spent most of their lifetime studying Islam, digging into Islam, trying to get to the bottom of it. And despite their, motives and their driving forces behind studying Islam, the fact is that many of them got a good grasp of Islamic knowledge. So they study Islam from Western perspective. However, many of them, a number of them, ended up being Muslim, embracing the religion of Islam by the grace of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the two major reasons why I studied Islamic studies in the West. I'm answering the question maybe because this is the most frequent question you might ask me at the end of this session. So yes, I have a number of discussions with many Orientalists as well as many missionaries who proselytize for their own religions. Not only Christianity, although many of them are Christians, but I had discussions beside Christianity with Jews and with also some minority religious groups there, like Jehovah Witnesses. If you ever heard about Jehovah Witnesses, the Mormons as well, the Unitarians as well. And by the way, the last three groups, minority groups, Jehovah Witnesses and Unitarians, Mormons, don't believe in the divinity of Jesus Christ. They believe in the oneness of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why they are not classified as Christians by the major Christian denominations and sect in the UK or in the West in general. So I have discussions with the members of these groups, and I remember one of the first people to discuss or to have discussions with them was one who met me at Costa there at the university. So I was reading a book in Arabic, and he approached me along with his colleague. He was a Christian missionary. He's working in the university to proselytize, and he was trying to convert me to Christianity. And that started a long journey, a long beautiful journey, and a long friendship with him. He approached me while sitting at Costa reading an Arabic book, and he asked me whether or not we can have discussion together. So I welcomed this initiative. So at the beginning, along with his friend, they asked me to introduce myself. I told them, from Oman, my name is so and so. So obviously I am Muslim. So at the first step, they told me, okay, can you tell us a little bit about Islam? So it turns out that I'm trying to convert them rather than them trying to convert me. And so I explained to them the pillars of Islam and the basic principles of Islam. Then that started a long journey of multi-religious dialogue and interfaith discussion. So we would meet regularly, and he reads the Bible, I read the Holy Quran. Whatever similarity we find, we share it with one another. And at the end of this journey, he came to appreciate what we have of Islam, that the legacy that we have, so much so, he was influenced and impacted by our discussion, so much so that he decided to take his master on Islamic studies. And he did his master on Islamic studies. One day he invited me to his house. And before I sit on his house on the sofa, what struck me is this book. For the first time I see this book on his house, on the shelf book, I was able to read from the spine, Oman. So Oman was shining from far away. So I was able to pick this word. Christianity in Oman? How come? I have never heard of Christian Omanis. So this question might be at the top of your heads as well. Many people ask me. So that started another journey to get to know the author of this book. We knew after 1 year later that he is still alive, and I was able to meet him 1 year later or even more and take written permission from him to translate his book. And this is what we have done. I translated the book into Arabic, and as I said, it will be launched at Muscat International Book Fair. In fact, the author of this book will be flying in 2 weeks' time on the 26th of February here to Oman. And on that evening, the same day, we will be having a book signing event for those of you who want to attend and to have their copies signed by the author. That would be at Muscat International Book Fair on the 26th of February, inshallah ta'ala. So, this is one of my friends. I have a number of debates with academics as well, professors as well. One of them, I'm not gonna mention the names, better not to mention particular names. One of them is a professor there at the Department of Theology and Religion. At the classroom, he mentioned that some scholars, he was trying to throw a misconception. And this is very important for any student who wants to go to the West to study, especially if he's studying religion or Islamic studies, to be well armed with Islamic studies, traditional Islamic studies from here, before he's exposed to so many misconceptions. Because the temptation of misconception there is severe and very strong. So unless you have a strong knowledge, the right knowledge, you would be lost. You might be lost there. So he mentioned this misconception. He said some Muslim scholars mentioned phrases, and then later on, this phrase becomes famous. And the later scholars of hadith, the prophetic tradition, they put isnad, a chain of narrators, just before it. And they say, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. They ascribe this famous statement to the Prophet himself. And he mentioned an example for that. He mentioned the narration, ما كان الله ليجمع أمتي على ضلال. Allah will never unite my ummah on misguidance. So he said that this statement was said by Imam Shafi'i. And Imam Shafi'i didn't say, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He mentioned it in one of his books, as he said. And later on, Al-Bukhari, who came 50 years after him, put an isnad, a chain of narrators, and he ascribed this very statement to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So this Orientalist is trying to misguide and mislead students. And this is, he said, this is the way many prophetic traditions and statements came to being. So I took the permission to comment on this misconception. I told him first, in our Islamic tradition, scholars mention verses from the Holy Quran, traditions from the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And because they are obvious, they are from the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, very famous statements, or they are Quranic verses. We don't have to say every now and then, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, or قال الله تعالى, because it is clear, it is obvious. And this is one of the famous hadith. So perhaps Imam Shafi'i didn't say, the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, because it is well known by his audience, by his target readers. So this is my first reply. And the second, I told him, this narration was reported by a correct and continuous chain of narrators all the way to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, by someone who lived before Shafi'i and by someone who lived before Al-Imam al-Bukhari, before Al-Imam al-Bukhari. It is reported, I told him, in Musnad Al-Imam al-Rabi' bin Habib. Al-Rabi' Sahih Collection of Hadith. Al-Rabi' bin Habib narrated this narration, and Al-Rabi' bin Habib died 30 years earlier than Al-Shafi'i and around 80 years earlier than Al-Imam al-Bukhari. So he said to me, did Al-Imam al-Rabi' really narrate it before Shafi'i? I told him, yes, it's there on the authority of Abu Ubaidah, Muslim ibn Abi Karim al-Tamimi, from Jabir ibn Zayd, from Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with them all, that the Prophet, peace be upon him, says, Allah will never unite my nation on misguidance. So this is one example of how the Orientalists try sometimes to mislead students or misguide students or confuse students. That might be intentional and that might be out of ignorance, because it seems he was ignorant of Musnad al-Imam al-Rabi' ibn Habib. Although he was aware of the Ibadi school of law. I do remember when I was first met him, that was at the office of the head of the Department of Theology and Religion. I was called to meet this professor because he was assigned as a teacher for me for a particular reason. They said, we need you, because he was retired and he was called to teach me along with a number of students. So they had to make sure that I'm happy with this professor. So the head of the Department of Theology and Religion phoned me, called me to come to see this professor. The moment he saw me with my Omani dress, he said to me, you are Khawarij. MashaAllah. From the very first day, what the hell they say? So I said, well, Omanis don't agree with that, are not happy with that. So I explained to him, in short, that Omanis might get offended by being called Khawarij. So I studied with him Islamic politics. Then towards the end of the semester, we had to choose the essay topic. So I chose the distinction between Ibadis and Kharijites, historical, theological, and political approach to that topic. So he was happy with that. And once I submitted my essay to him at the end of the semester, and he said to me, this is a reply to my first claim. Well, consider it as you think. And he was, I think, just by giving me distinction on this essay. So this is one interesting story that has just come to my mind. As I said, I can go on and on and on talking about different experiences. I'll speak about some of my encounters, not only experience, with one of the famous Orientalists there in the West. He taught me a number of modules, and in one occasion I do remember that he says that he was talking about the biography of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. On one occasion he says that Buhayra the monk was always behind Muhammad. So that struck me as well. So at the end of the discussion, I went to his table at the classroom. I told him, what do you mean by Buhayra being always behind the Prophet Muhammad? He was trying to tell students that what Muhammad related to us, of stories of those who lived before us, of this legislation and so on and so on, was inspired to Muhammad by Buhayra the monk, Al-Rahib Buhayra. So he said to me, I told him, what do you mean by Buhayra being always behind the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? He said, well, this is what the Orientalists say, because when I discuss with him and he doesn't have a response, he says, this is what always the Orientalist says. So I told him, what do you mean by Buhayra was always behind the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him? As the matter of fact, from a hadith viewpoint, if we come to discuss this issue, from the hadith viewpoint, the name Buhayra and the story of Buhayra and the name of Buhayra the monk meeting the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was not mentioned, was not related to us except from Ibn Ishaq. Ibn Ishaq, the famous biographer, writer of the seer of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Sirat Ibn Ishaq. And Ibn Ishaq mentioned this story without a chain of narrators, without isnad. So, from a hadith viewpoint, this narration is not authentic. We cannot accept it in the discussion as an authentic hadith. We cannot build on it any discussion. This is from one angel. From another angel, the matter of fact is that Buhayra was not always behind the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Because if we say for the sake of argument that this narration is authentic, Buhayra was not always behind the Prophet Muhammad. He only met him when he was a little child, when he was 9 years old, according to a narration, to another narration, when he was 12 years old. So only it was a passing encounter. It was just a passing encounter. And he wasn't with the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when it was revealed to him 30 years later. Because the Prophet, it was revealed to the Prophet, sent to people when the Prophet was 40 years old, not when he was 9 or 12 years old. And he wasn't, Buhayra by that time was dead. Another thing I told him that then he said that Muhammad was reading and writing, okay? So as if he was saying Muhammad was copying, okay? I told him Muhammad, peace be upon him, was an illiterate man. He said, this is your argument. Who said he's an illiterate man? I told him it is there in the Holy Quran. If Muhammad, peace be upon him, would read and write, his own companions would be the first one to tell him that you are a liar, because you lived with us and you were reading and writing, because you would, we have manuscripts and written works that you wrote by your own hand, writing. But none of that happened. They will belie him and call him a liar, because it is there in the Holy Quran that Muhammad doesn't read nor does he write. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I mentioned to him two verses from the Holy Quran. The first verse which says, الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّيِّ. Those who follow the illiterate prophet, الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ, whom they find written in what they have of Torah and the Gospel. So the verse here is explicit that Muhammad was illiterate. So if he would read and write, then his companions would tell him, how come you tell us here in the Quran you are illiterate? Then you must be a liar. And another verse that says, وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ. You don't read nor do you write. وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ. You would neither recite a scripture before the Quran, nor would you read or write. So this is another verse I mentioned. So he said, it's just what the Orientalists say. Then if the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, reads and writes, where did he copy the scripture? Because he claims that he copies from the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Bible. The Bible has the Old Testament and the New Testament. Was the Bible translated at that time into Arabic? No, it wasn't. The Old Testament, which is the Jewish scripture, was only translated in the 10th century, 3 centuries after the demise and the departure of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. As for the New Testament, the Christians' scripture, it was translated in the 14th century, to my knowledge. So that means 6 or 7 centuries later. So if you want to say that Muhammad would read and write and he copied from the old previous scripture, that means he speaks another language. He reads and writes from another language, which wasn't the case. And we had another discussion one day in another module, another class, in another semester. Once he gave us, he distributed to the students A4 sheet, like any A4 sheet. And this A4 sheet has two texts. Okay, both of them obviously are in English, and there is a line between the two texts. And he told us figure out what these texts are about and where are they from. So it was clear for a number of the students that the first text is from the Holy Quran, the story of the birth of the Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, the miraculous birth of the Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, and when he spoke in his cradle, when he was a young boy, in his infancy. That is from Surah Maryam, as you know, the chapter of Mary, the 19th chapter of the Holy Quran. And the other text, none of us was able to tell where the other text from, which conforms to the content of the upper text, to the other text, which means the content is almost the same with different wording. Only one student was able to tell which this text is from. My friend Fred, who was trying to convert me into Christianity when we met in Costa. He was the only student who was able to tell the second text is from what is called the infancy gospel of Thomas. I'll talk about this gospel later on. So he said to us, okay, then what conclusion can you derive? The first text from the Holy Quran and the second text from a particular gospel, the infancy gospel of Thomas. So I was the first one to answer his question. What conclusion can we draw from these similarities? Obviously, I was the first one to try to comment to the answer, because I know what he is trying to tell the students. He was trying to tell the students Muhammad copied from the gospel. So I told him in front of the students that if we have two similar texts with two students, the content is the same, but maybe with different wording, slight different wording. Before we jump into claiming that one of the students plagiarized and copied the other, we assume first one of the students or both of the students might have studied under the same teacher, might have studied the same subject or module, might have heard the same lecture, might have read the same book. So they have the same source, and each one of them put the same content in its own words. But it seems this answer doesn't satisfy what he wants, doesn't meet his purpose. And he said, no, this is not an academic answer. So one of the students commented that this is from the infancy gospel of Thomas, and Muhammad might have copied this text from the infancy gospel of Thomas. So I did my research. I wasn't well aware of the infancy gospel of Thomas, so I did my research. It's interesting findings, what I came to know. The infancy gospel of Thomas only was discovered in 1945, in the 20th century only, in a tomb, in a coffin with a monk. It was buried from the 3rd century, 4 centuries before the coming of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, or 4 centuries or three centuries, almost four centuries before the coming, it was this text was buried with that monk. Four centuries before the coming of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And it was only discovered in 1945, in the 20th century, the previous century. So during the life of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, there was no text called the Infancy Gospel of Thomas. And what is so striking is that the Infancy Gospel of Thomas was not written in Arabic. Neither of obviously in English, because English wasn't born at that time. When was English born? Do you know? In 1066, when the Normans invaded the Saxons, and English now obviously is a combination mainly of Western Germanic languages and Normans language, the French tribes who invaded England in 1066. So the English was not born even during the 3rd century. So it was written in old Coptic. And it was discovered, where was it discovered? It was discovered in Egypt, in a Coptic or Coptic speaking environment. Until now, this place in which this Infancy Gospel of Thomas was discovered, they are Christians. Coptic Christians, and some of them speak Coptic. So did the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, have access to Coptic? Did he have any access to this Infancy Gospel? Although two interesting stories mentioned in this Gospels that were not mentioned in any other Gospel. The story of Jesus, peace be upon him, speaking in his cradle, in his infancy, and also the story of Jesus, peace be upon him, making a clay bird, then breathing into that bird and becomes life by the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you mention either of these two stories to a Christian nowadays, they are likely to be ignorant of these two stories. The Christian world has been ignorant of these two stories from the 3rd century, for 17th century, from the 3rd century till the 20th century. Yet, both of them are mentioned in the Holy Quran. So the big question, who told the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, of these two stories? It is the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is an inspiration from Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the angel Jibreel, peace be upon them both. So that's another interesting story. I have, as I said, I can go on and on and on narrating and relating more other stories, but maybe I should stick to the time given to me, 40 minutes. I was given 40 minutes. I'm running out of time, so I leave the rest of my talk to the discussion if the students have some questions, and that's all what I have to say in my talk. So we'll open the floor to the audience. Okay.
I may go out. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Go out of topic, but since you are talking about English culture and Western culture and the clash between Occidental and Oriental, so I'm a translator, as well as my wife, she is Spanish speaker, and we translate from English to Spanish, and have read so many books, Islamic books. We found that there are some Spanish books, we think that they are spreading here in Oman and in some Islamic countries, and touching deeply and dangerously the sacred name of the Prophet Muhammad, and they are misguiding with the bad intention about the translating. I'm talking about Spanish, of course. So we have to also focus on other languages, which is, I mean, come the second after English, because it has their followers and it has their speakers as well.
Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing. It's very important to translate the Holy Quran into different languages. And this translation has to be revised thoroughly, I would say. Because some of the translation of the Holy Quran, had mistakes actually. So unless there are committees to translate the Quran into a particular language, the translation, the individual translation would have some mistakes, might have some mistakes. I do remember here the verse which says, أُذِنَ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا. One of the translators read it, أُذِنَ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ. He misread it and he translated, permission has been given to those who are fighting, not to those who are being fought. And regarding Spanish, Spanish is a very common, widespread language in Latin America, especially, so it is an important language. And regarding the attack on the personality of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, it's found in the Catholic, especially, culture. And the worst, I would say, episode of Spanish history is the Inquisition. The Spanish Inquisition, if you read about it, is the worst, the darkest spot in Spanish history. And it's part of the, sorry, I don't want to offend anybody, but it's part of the Catholic culture to use the savage, if I can say, and more severe and terrible way to punish and torture others. And this is not confined to Spanish, even English people, the bloody Queen Mary is no exception to this, which ask to burn people who are not Catholics, opposing the Reformation, Protestant Reformation, and killing even the children by the edge of the sword. And this was applied even to Muslims, to the people of this land, Oman. When the Catholic, the Portuguese Catholics came to Oman, they killed Omanis, burned Omanis alive, and they distort their faces, disguise their faces as well. This has happened here in Oman. So yes, it's important to do such translation and to study the other religions, because nowadays we are accused of being savage and terrible and terrorists. And while these things are even found in their culture as well. Thank you for the additional comment. No. The question was about, it was more a comment than a question, I guess, and a comment on the translation, the efforts of translation from Spanish into Arabic and vice versa. And also what was mentioned about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Spanish writing. Okay?
Yes, that what I was saying.
Yes.
Instead of saying Muhammad, see, every time when you speak, even in English, you say Muhammad, you are pronouncing and say it correctly without any mistake. But they are translating to the name other Ma'oma,
yeah,
in Spanish.
Mm.
So when they say this, they have bad intention, because in Spanish culture, it is a different person. He is not the Prophet Muhammad, but always they're making this name as example for the Prophet Muhammad.
Mm.
So what's wrong with you? Why don't you say it? Because the sacred name, you cannot translate it.
Correct. It has to be kept in its pronunciation.
Exactly. So not even in Quran. In all books, there's talking about Islam. Even, I can say that with regret, even some Muslims, they are putting this name which has, I say again, it has bad intentions to insult the Prophet Muhammad.
To use a short form of Muhammad.
It's not a short form, it's a different person. It's actually a character.
Correct.
Yes, he is a character, he's a person, but he is not a Prophet Muhammad.
Yes.
He's a different person.
Correct, yeah. And there is a similar pronunciation to Mahudi. They are used in the Western writing. And Mahudi is the god of the devil as well. So they are trying to use different names or similar names that were associated with the devil, with the evil, and so on. And they are, I mean, many of these are intentional, many of them are not maybe intentional, especially by the common people, by the public, by masses. They just follow what is written there, but they, many of them suffer of ignorance. I do remember that many of them think that Muhammad's body is floating in the Kaaba. Many of them believes, especially before the Crusades. So yeah, thank you for that. Any other question? Any other question?
That some professors are open to hearing new things, while others are really opposed. Mm-hmm. And you can put yourself as a student, you can put yourself into, you know, you can get a bad name and not get good marks because you're always discussing with the professor. What do you suggest?
Yes, as you mentioned, some of them, many of them, perhaps most of them, they have that sort of hatred in their hearts. So this very person, which it seems naughty with him, he told me one day, don't try to teach me. In discussion, it was me and him. Don't try to teach me. I've been studying Islam for 35 years. And you are coming now to teach me what I have studied for 35 years. So some of them have that arrogance. Some of them really have that arrogance, but others are humble to the truth whenever they find the truth. In fact, one of them told us from the beginning, you can correct me, criticize me, reply to me of anything I say during the course of the lecture. So people are of different tastes and they come from different walks of life. Thank you.
So as a student, you need to find out who you can, you know, who's amenable to discussion and really keep quiet where
yes. As long as the discussion is in a respectful way with the students, he cannot, dismiss your answer, or he cannot be disrespectful for you in front of the teachers, because they are teaching in secular universities, and they are asked to be open-minded, and they are asked to detach themselves from their own beliefs. So this is the methodology, the academic methodology in the West. So my advice to Muslim students is that never be ashamed of your religion. Never try to hide your own identity. Be proud of your identity. Yes, stick to the academic principles of discussion. Be so respectful while discussing others, even having dialogue with others. And as long as you are adhering and sticking to the respectful manners, never be afraid of discussing, of exposing your own opinions. And the decision is theirs, whether they accept your argument or they don't accept. In academic, in secular universities, they are required to listen to all people, despite of their religious background, despite of their sectarian or religious beliefs. They have to open the floor to everybody. And the conviction is something else. And guidance is not an intellectual issue. These people might know Islam better than we do. Okay? So, but still they are not Muslims. Many of them are not Muslims. And that tells us that guidance is not just an intellectual issue, intellectual matter. Guidance is from Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of his name is Al-Hadi. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that those who seek his path, his way, sincerely he will guide them. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who strive for us, for our sake, we will surely guide them our way. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And indeed, Allah is with the doers of good. So Allah is just. Whoever seeks his way sincerely, faithfully, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide them. But if they start their research and their study with the previous assumptions, with a particular agenda to serve their own agenda, then prosperity and tawfiq, guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not be granted to them. In fact, what they acquire of knowledge would be like an evidence, a proof to them on the day of resurrection when they turn a blind eye to the truth. So this is my advice to the students. Be proud of who you are. Never be ashamed of yourself, of your culture, of your country, of your religion. Try to discuss in wisdom. أدعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة. This is what Allah has commanded us. Call to the way of Allah in wisdom and good preaching, good manner. And Islam is all about good manner. And this is what affects people. And here I recall a story from our late Sultan, His Majesty Sultan Qaboos bin Sa'id bin Taymur, may his resting place be showered with mercy. That His Majesty, because of his conduct in the UK when he was studying in the England, this good moral conduct invited others to Islam without him speaking or preaching Islam. Allow me to mention this interesting story. His Majesty the Sultan Qaboos was studying at the Royal Academy of Sandhurst. It is a military Royal Academy, Sandhurst. And there he came to meet someone whose name was Alfred France. Alfred France was a prince, was one of the wealthy British people, and he was pushed by his parents to come to Sandhurst, because it's a university or a college, military college, only rich people, princes, and princes come to this college. So he met the Sultan Qaboos, His Majesty late Sultan Qaboos, and he was surprised because His Majesty wasn't like any Arab prince. He doesn't drink. He doesn't have relations with the opposite sect and so on and so forth. He's always with his study. So he said to him, why are you doing this? He said to him, because I'm a Muslim. This is what my religion instructs me to do. He said to him, okay, tell me about Islam. His Majesty Sultan Qaboos told him, learn first your religion, practice first your religion, then come to ask me later on about Islam. First, know your religion first. So the guy, Alfred France, went to his home. He opened the Bible. He started reading the Bible. He started going as well to the church. So his two parents were so happy, extremely happy, because their child is coming back to the religion. And they asked him, what changed you? What has changed you? What happened with you? There must be something happened to you. We've been trying to convince you to come back to the religion, but we failed to do so. But then later on, all of a sudden, you came back to the religion. He told them, I came to know a prince, an Arab prince, and he asked me, before I know his religion, and I should read my religion, because he was on the top moral conduct. So as a way of saying thank you, his parents invited His Majesty the Sultan Qaboos to their palace. So His Majesty went to his palace and they asked him about his conduct. Are you doing this because you are a crown prince? He said, no, I'm not doing this because I'm a crown prince, because they knew that his father was the leader of Oman, the Sultan of Oman. He told them, no, I'm not doing this because I'm a crown prince. I'm doing this because I'm following my religion. And so he left them, and that words, those words, left a great impact on this boy, and he graduated later on from another university or college. He became so wealthy because he was leading and managing his parents' companies, and he was always remembering the words of this Arab prince. Then he decided to read Arabic, to read the Holy Quran. And then he started reading the biography of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then he was fully convinced of Islam. Then he embraced Islam. He became a Muslim. Later on, he studied Arabic, learned Arabic, read and wrote in Arabic. And he was able to read the Holy Quran in Arabic. He came to Al-Hajj several times. He married to a Muslim woman. He had children from her. Later on, he wrote a message to His Majesty the Sultan Qaboos, reminding him of their old discussion and telling him he had a great favor on him when he asked him to learn his religion. Then he should know then later on about Islam. So moral conduct, I mean, is a very powerful way to invite others to Islam. And this is not because of us trying to pretend good. This is part and parcel of our Islamic tradition. The Almighty says, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. Say to people good words. And He asks us to treat people with goodness. Okay? Thank you. Maybe I should bring the session to close, to an end. Okay, that's all I have to say tonight. I hope what I have said of benefit to you all. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make what we said on our scale on the day of resurrection. And thank you again, Islamic Culture Society, for inviting me. Thank you also for attending and being part of this panel discussion. Until I see you again on another occasion, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Oh,